Hi, this is Ellie Murta. If you've been watching the videos of this channel since Faísca became a virtual festival, you've probably heard about one of our interviewees for this video, the artist and printmaster Jo Franken, head of the printing and publishing lab at the Jan van Eyck Academy in Maastricht, the Netherlands. Through him, we met another fantastic artist whose name is Mix van Born, also from the Netherlands, but currently living in the Isle of Mull in Scotland. For this video, I talked to both of them about the series of artist books that they developed together. Now you can learn a bit more about the Centum Nec Plura series, from number 1 to number 6, as well as a little on what's about to come. This video was recorded on January 7, 2021. Hope you enjoy it!
Hi, Mick, Jo, very nice to have you here. Very nice to see you again.
Hi, Helen.
Thank you for inviting us.
Nice to have us again for another project.
Yeah, I usually start the interviews as it is common, asking people to introduce themselves. Today I have you both here. I would like to change it a little, and I would like to ask you, each one of you, to introduce the other person.
Well, it's a couple of years ago, Mick was invited as our first poet in residence at the Jan van Eyck. It was a short time residency, especially made for poets and writers. And we started working together on a little project. And I, of course, started reading her novels. And so yeah, that was very interesting. We liked each other. Yeah, she's a writer, artist, translator, ad hoc scientist, she does scuba diving, cooking. So, well, I just can go on. I'm sure she does everything. I only do a little thing. And because we went along so much and I liked her work, I had an idea 3-4 years ago to make a series of books at the Jan van Eyck. At moments that there was not too much to do, that I could interweave making of a series with her. So I invited her, do you feel for that? Because that was the moment she also went to the Isle of Mull in Scotland. And I said, maybe that would be a very nice theme for the books, that it's all about what her adventures in Mull and her writing about it, the drawings and the photos she make. And then I would make at the Jan van Eyck Academy, I would make publications out of it.
Jo Franken is a printmaster who is leading the print workshop on the Jan van Eyck in Maastricht. That's a postgraduate academy or institute for artists that wanted to study there for a year extra. I got to know Jo a little bit before that first month, because I was together with a friend organizing some walks. And Jo did little booklets for these walks. And these experience printing Rizzo for the first time with somebody who is so dedicated to that way of printing, but also so able to solve all kind of problems underway, but also have the most exciting solutions for impossible ideas. That was really, for me, something very, very special and something very attractive. So when I came back on the Jan van Eyck and we started to see each other again and working on little test prints, and Jo came up with the idea of making this series, I was very, very happy with that proposal, because there's nothing so beautiful than working together with somebody who is so into the process of making something beautiful as a as a book. I really miss it now, like being in the workshop and seeing you running, not running, but walking through the space, handling all these machines. And we are very, very different in our way of thinking, and therefore we have a very nice ping pong effect. So there's something that Jo puts me always in another direction than I would do myself. So that is a very, good way to work for me.
In what ways do you think you're very different?
Oh, wouldn't have said that.
She's much nicer than I am.
maybe I work more intuitive. When I have an idea for a book, it is more, it's already a bit visual, but it's a lot, it goes also much about how it feels inside, or a certain kind of atmosphere or a feeling that I get when I think about it. And in the beginning, then I never have a clue how it will look like. And I'm not very sure, but I think in that way, Jo is more visual and sees them. Jo, is that true? Maybe I'm...
that's true, but that was also one reason to invite you, that you were different from me, because otherwise it would not be interesting. I must say that I'm more a rational science guy, and Mieke is real and more arts and intuitive working person. So that's already guaranteed to lead to two different approaches to things. But that sometimes clashes a little bit, or is a little bit friction. And then we have to fight for our space. So I want something, and then Mick is making comments, or the other way around. So we constantly have to negotiate actually about the outcome. So when I started the book, I was a bit naive, because I thought Mick will provide me with the material. So that means images, poems, and then I do my thing with it. But since Mieke is not only a writer, but also an artist, she also has those visual preferences on things. Actually it got more intense, where she also intervenes with layout things, image things. So we have to constantly to discuss things. And then sometimes it takes a lot of effort to try to convince, and sometimes things are compromises. And in the end, we are both happy. That's the main thing. That's in short, it's the different. We are completely different in
that's where world. You find the opportunities, right?
Yes, but we are maybe the thing that we meet each other is on art. Autonomous productions and so on. And because we are both very curious people, if I ask Mieke something, and then the next week she knows everything about the subject, and that's also the way I work. So if I am confronted with a new thing, then I spend a lot of time to try to find everything about that. And that is the curiosity that actually connects us. I think that's maybe the main thing that it works.
When I began to search about the CNP series, I went to search the meaning first, of course, and I put it on the dictionary. And when I saw that it was 100 and no more, how do you pronounce?
Centum nec plura. It's Latin.
I thought, well, they probably put this name because they will make 100 books together.
That's true. That's true. But not only that, because then there will be an end, and that's, you better will not know it before. someone has to stop when it's 36 or something like that. I don't know.
I was talking to Mick a little bit before this interview, and we see that the work you're doing at Nok Vologon Studies and the work about the Moe Island gets everyone very curious about what you're doing out there. I would like to ask you to tell us about this work.
So four years and a half, I moved from Amsterdam to Moe. I will, because it's nice to show where I live. I live here. and it is right on the gate of one of the first rewilding lands from the United Kingdom. So 25 years ago, there was a project manager, and she advised some people who owned the land to put a fence around and to study what will happen with the land, because all around it is grazed by sheep. So actually, it's not really a natural landscape. And when I was on holiday on Mull, I met the owners of this land, and they suddenly proposed me and my partner to look after the house on the gate of this land, and also on the land itself. Although rewilding land, you don't have to look after a lot. I mean that you have to leave it, especially. Moving to here, we started to think, what could we do here, except of looking after this place? And then after lots of thoughts, we thought it would be really nice to share the landscape with other artists and writers and composers. So we started to make an artist in residence place for other people to come to work here, but also for the local people to work with people from far away in art fields and music fields and literature fields. The project was about how will the landscape recover from human behavior or human
occupying there.
But that was not really a job, and of course we had to think about, what do we do if you stay here? How could you also have a little income, and especially how can you share this beautiful place with other people? Because living here on your own, I mean, that's too much for one person or a couple. There's so much possibilities in the landscape to research and to make work about, or to share work about this landscape. I could maybe explain it the best that I see it as a collection where we're working on together with many people, and the subject is always, like the series I make with Jo, the landscape here and the critters here. People come to this artist in residence place to work here, but they always would work on a subject that they found here. So it's not somebody who brings his paintings and paints and go back. People who come here, they are, well, that would be really, really nice. Would be forever connected to Nok Vologon, like a circle of people who are connected by the landscape, and also by the discussions about their work and future of the landscape.
And the name Nok Vologon, it's the study place, but where does it come from?
So the name, we called it Nok Vologon Studies, and Nok Vologon is the village, which is just three houses, and it means it's a bit unclear what it means, but it means near the hill, and the rewilding land, that's clear what it means. That's called Tireragan, and that means the land of angry waves, and it is very, very tough to the people have lived there. But it's really, really tough. Very remote and very rough, hilly landscape, very boggy and also wet in winter. It's just the fields are just underwater all the time.
you enter the subject of Thierry Regan, and that's the first one you've published on CNP. So can we go like back a little and tell us about the name that you got from Charles Nipples, is that right?
Yeah, the thing is that the printing lab at the Jan van Eyck was renamed by the previous director, and he renamed all the labs to important people in Maastricht and surroundings. And Charles Nipples was a printer and designer, an artist in the early 20th century. And he had also a print shop in Maastricht. So that the name was Charles Nipples. And he was a very good designer and a very good artist, but a lousy businessman. So he...
That's like a classic, right?
Yes, that's classic. So he was commissioning himself to a very nice series of books about Don Quixote, a very luxury edition. And then the firm almost got bankrupt, and he was expelled from Maastricht. He had to move. They kicked him out, and a brother also took the business over to save the business from bankruptcy. And he went living in Utrecht, I think. And then he made his own press, and it was the Charles Nipples Press. CNP, which CNP also is then his series of books he wants to make, artist books, and that was Centum Nec Plura, and that means 100 and no more. So he started with the first issue. I bought that. It's a very erotic subject. It's from 1932. So I bought this. It cost me a fortune. But the nice thing is that okay, this is then you see, it's Centum Nec Plura, number one, and he never made another one. So when he made this book, it was also the last one, and then we said okay. Then when we start the series with the same idea about only 100 copies, the idea about poetry and illustrations, yeah, that was actually the connection.
And this one, you have a copy out of 100. There are only 100 and you have one there.
Yes, and that was why it was so expensive. So our first one was number 2. You see, it's the same typography. As this one. And so number one is the only one. And there were also some other things what we found in here. For example, this title page. There you see it were erotic drawings like on the cover. And we also used this as our logo. At CNP. So CNP is also Charles Nipples Press. And I would really name also the press, the publishing press we do also CNP. Yeah. And there was a model. This is all letterpress, all done in letterpress, very beautiful. You see, it's very aesthetically on the page, very classic. And then we tried to find out which type that he used. So we were looking in the colophon. So this is the colophon. And then I saw that the type he used was the cushion. So we thought, okay, that's also very nice for us to use the cushion then. And then I was looking like hell to find it, and I couldn't find it. And in the end, it was one of the 3 types in the Macintosh operating system.
Okay.
So it was there already a long time before I even knew it. But anyway, that was, so these things like literature, image, not more than 100, that type, that were actually our starting points. And then, rigid as I am, I try to make it all over design, kind of a art direction for the whole series. And I think, okay, then let's make all square books. This is about Tiragamya, Mick just talked about. I think we make all square books, all made in this way, perfect bounds. And so we only managed to make two of the series in this format. And then we already rejected it. But that's also, yeah, a good lesson for me. So that it's very difficult to be that rigid in your approach. So you have to change plans, but we talk about that later.
It has like photos from above and poems. Would you tell us about this content?
Yeah, the images, they are all, actually they're all fragments of this map. And this is a map we made. This is a satellite map, but with enlarging a lot of screenshots and putting them together. There's now this very, very sharp, detailed map. And we took little bits of this map that are all the coastline around Tiraragon. And because it was the first publication and we did not really knew the land already a lot, it was just landing there and feeling very, very new and strange in this wild landscape, that we decided to, that we could also do everything in colors very free with a map. So all the color combinations are Joost, beautiful decisions that are one in just in gold, there's one in red and green, and this one, it made it very, really other colors than the real colors. And then I started to write, actually, it was really to understand where we started to live and what was under our feet. A long poem came out that I tried to imagine how this landscape started long time ago with the volcanic eruptions, and because it's all a volcanic rock bed, and then slowly some lichen and some plants came. So the poem is woven through the bits of the map, and they're printed on a very, I don't know if you can see it, if you show it now, but the paper is very thin. So you the language is really like streaming almost over the maps. Yeah, and it's both Dutch and English.
That is a thin paper. Do you use the transparent one as well?
Yes, it's the transparent one we also use for the last issue. And here you see it's black and brown for the different languages.
You said, Mick, you were like meeting the place and you started to feel the place and also to research, right? Because you started to imagine how it came to be that way. You can put your observations and also your feelings. And we can feel as well. How do you think that in this book?
It was a bit complicated because writing in Dutch and then arriving on a Scottish island where the land that I came to was a Gaelic speaking, not now anymore, but it is a Gaelic speaking area with a landscape that in Dutch there are not really words for the new things I saw. It was also quite a search to come up with the words that would fit on my walks and on my and the feeling that I had. And there was a lot I did not understand about how would have been shaped in history, what kind of species live there. There's this thick patch of peat. So this is all these layers of old plants that are still on top of the rock beds, but it is it felt also a kind of magic, but also so far away from everything I've seen before or if I've knew before. But it's also felt all very alive, although it was a lot of rocks and a lot of water. It all feels like there's so much going on there, and it's so old. The writing is not really a process that, it's a lot about being out and waiting. And sometimes I think about this poem, and that's that I even don't know. I'm sure I cannot write something like that now anymore, because it's, I now know the place better. So maybe I would choose words that would fit better and would make it less interesting, because it is too, it becomes more scientific. When you compare it with the poem, this poem in the book, so, it does not really fit, and that makes it maybe so interesting.
Did you think more about this design or the colors and everything, thinking more about the images themselves, or did the poems also influence, for instance, on the choosing of the colors mm-hmm. of the book? Is mm-hmm. that a thing or not?
No, in this case, for me, it was not, because Meek provided me with both the images and the poems, but the images, they were all, they all were the same original. So they were full color images. And mm-hmm. what I did then, I started playing with them. I started to play with the channels. So sometimes I printed in one channel, then in two, then I mixed up the channels, the cyan became the magenta and so on. So I was playing, and how I approached it was actually, I just started with the first, and I only started thinking about the next one when the first was finished. So there was no program, all over program that I just did, like I usually like to do. But this was also a bit liberating, and that was also the reason that it took a lot more time, because you have constantly, you reset, you go back to the beginning, and then you make a new decision. And so that was actually my approach to it. And then we worked together in collating the book, and then Meek and I decided the sequence of the images. We put all the parts together, and then we decided the order of the book. So which color, which page came then, first, last. So it was a very intuitive process. So what do we like? So you cannot actually, it's not a map that you can follow, because it's completely cut up. One thing I want to say, still, it's a very nice effect about those two papers, is I browse like this, and you only see poems. You see?
You see poems with a little bit of the image.
Yeah. And then when I do this, you only see the images. So I always do only this. I make always this. But that's a nice effect about those two papers. It's a kind of a physical adherence to the back. But that was very nice. I really liked that when I discovered that it worked like that. And then for the cover, since we always use Perfect Bound with gold glue, so for the cover we use the same. And since Rizzo is really smearing a lot, because it always stays wet, you in the meantime, you know everything about that, Helen. Then we always put a screen print varnish on top of it. So now you can touch it so that it will not smear. So we mostly do work with a varnish, or we make a screen print like the last one. It was only screen print. So, but that's actually the approach when we do things like that. So that's actually it. It was just playing with colors mm-hmm. and with images. And then sometimes it also goes wrong. Then it doesn't have the output that you expect it to be. You have to start over again. It's actually like painting.
Well, I would like to comment, just for us to close a little the subject on this book, because we have others to discuss, but some things that called my attention was, like, for instance, when you have the light between the rocks, how do you think this material was in terms of the result you chose, how these pages work together?
I don't think that if you look through the book that you get a little glimpse of this landscape, and you can definitely see that there are not many people living on it, and that is quite rocky, and that there are hills and a lot of water, and that comes very close to how daily life is around here, and also about how the landscape is every minute so different. Really, the light, it's sometimes such a theatrical light show. There are days here and the one rainbow after the other, and then there's one hill in full light, and then there's this pink sky, and sometimes I think, like, oh, I'm a bit tired of all these effects. And I like it that here in the first book that it is about the land, and it is about the seashore, but it is also about something more universal, or more like an alien space still, because of all these different colors as well. If I look through, it exists, but it also is almost like a landscape of the imagination, and that's, it brings back the feeling when I now look through it, how it was when we came and how different it is now, because now, like this island now, that now I know very well because I spent one night with my tent on it, and that really changed the whole bay, because when you spend some time on a place, there starts a connection between your own moments on that island and this huge amount of time that other species or families of seals have lived there already for centuries. And that's when we made this book, it was so new all. I was maybe as well very alien.
One thing that I think it's interesting, the next book would be Oology, is that right?
Yeah.
It's interesting that you started with these shots from above and showing like the map and everything, and then you go like zoom in and show like the nests and the eggs. Well, could we talk a little about Oology? For that, we'll see. Also, a square book in the same format. It was the second one you used, like the same format.
Yeah. Only thicker. With me, everything gets thicker always.
Thicker and bigger, yeah.
I saw the description, and you were telling that about those photographers that made the first photographs of bird nests. Is that right? Was that your inspiration?
Yeah. I already a few years ago, one of the favorite libraries, my favorite libraries, is the library connected to the zoo in Amsterdam. It's a beautiful collection of all books about animals and plants. And I when I was there quite some years ago, I found this book. I now have it myself, and this is about two brothers, the first wildlife photographers, and I like them immediately because they were so inventive by building their shelters to watch birds, and they like
I'm sorry, what's the name of the book?
Oh, the name of the book is Wildlife at Home. So they wrote a lot of, one brother was writing and the other one was more the technical photographer. And they made books about, there one is at work with a cloth around him, looking almost himself like a bird. For example, they built this fake tree. Here you see it, the open door, and here the tree is closed.
Like a cabin.
They made masks. They would hide in a canoe that had painted with leaves over it. They would climb, a tree together with a ladder to come very close to the nest. And they were the first persons who didn't take the nest out of the trees or from the rocks to bring it home to make a sharp photograph in the studio, because of course it was all glass plates and heavy camera and tripods, but they were so keen to do it in situ and to catch that real situation. So one part of the book is archive material from these two brothers, and the other part was photographs of birds' nests and eggs that I found around Nokwolligan. And then there is a little part where also Jo have made some jumping eggs. Can you show that, Jo?
Oh, yes. Yeah. So it's maybe good to say that my idea about this series is it should not be educational or instructive. So what I don't like, for example, if there was captions with the images, for example. So I think for me, it's very important that the images are quite autonomous and not explanatory. Otherwise you end up giving a biology course about eggs. Yeah? So I really like it to be inspired by the images and make an artist book, a whole, this is a, is one thing actually, and that's what I like about it. So and so sometimes you have to watch that doesn't happen, so that it stays more free. Okay, now I go to the X. maybe it's nice, Mick, to tell what was the inspiration for that.
In the first visit to the library in Amsterdam, I looked in another book of this Richard and Cherry Keerton, and there was a whole page with eggs, really like very formal positioned on the page, color. I think it was a copper printing page. They lived around 1880. And one of these eggs was that it was an egg of a bluebird, but it was printed slightly next to the, so it were different layers of ink, but one for the bluebird was slightly out of position, and it was therefore it became two eggs almost. Yeah, you saw the blue egg, but you saw also the one underneath, very like almost like if it was a ghost or something crazy happening on the page. And then later, Jo made his own version of the moving egg.
Here you see the two eggs. Yeah? And I just separated the color plates. Okay, see these are actually the three different color plates for that same egg. It was a full color image. And then we separated it, but then I mimicked actually that idea about that wrong printing. The nice thing is here, Mick and I, we meet together, because this is actually the signature of my kind of work. But Mick is, she also likes the outcome, but she's also interested in how it came this way, like the story. But I'm very interested in the visual opportunities I have with this. So we always end up in friendship, that we are both happy with things. So here is also it's also do another two eggs, but also then on top of it the other egg. Now you only see it.
That's the one for the buzzard, the buzzard egg. Okay.
Could you tell us more about those visual opportunities? Because I think it's very interesting, your observation, because it's hard to do this because we are talking about artist books. Maybe it loses a little about the sensorial way of seeing the book. So could you tell us a little bit more, Jo, about the visual and this handcraft paper that you had there and this project, you know?
I always like to play with the layers, what I said. I always make color separations, and then I mess them up, actually, in a nice way. And here, I also got the opportunity to use the transparent paper as an extra layer on top of it. So first, I thought I would use three transparencies that I put on top of each other, but that was actually a bit too obvious. So I think I use one with the two colors and one transparency, just to not to be too direct in those things. And so that was actually where I was playing with, and it came out very well. But the nice thing is what you see, that a mistake in a book from the 19th century, a little mistake there that Mick points out, already starts the imagination to do something with it. It all came together. It was my interest about how to work with things, with formal things, and Mick's interest about the story.
Yeah, would you like to comment?
Well, maybe I can say a little bit about the patterns on birds' eggs. Mm-hmm. Because no bird egg is the same. And what I found intriguing was that that the pictures of the nest from the Kirtan brothers, mm-hmm. that I found in the books, I found the same constellation from the nest in this time. So a nest from a heron would exactly be the same a long time ago as the heron now would lay its eggs upcoming spring. So there's a beautiful long line of things that don't change. And then because these patterns are so individual, we thought that would be really nice to have as well some of them in the book. And there is even a name for this paper with an egg pattern on it, and that is plover paper. In Dutch, it is kievitspapier, which means lapwing paper, so a different bird for the same paper. And it was used in the 18th and 19th century for the second page of a book. I think it was just because it is already a little bit of messy paper, and if you make the book messy, you won't see it that much or something. Something like that.
Plover is the name of the bird.
That is a bird that lives close to the water and also is a migrating bird here. Then we invited, you already showed it, a German bookbinder who I met at that time as well, to make for us plover paper. But one is for the crow, for the hooded crow that is nesting around Volgen, that is this one. And one is for the guillemot. That is a bird that almost only lives on a rock. And the other one is, the brown one. Yeah, that's for the snipe. In this little, actually the pages are not inside out, but they are closed and you have to open them as a reader. So there is this.
There's a perforation. You see the perforation?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I opened one, especially for this moment.
Yeah. Oh, I also had one open.
Oh, she's perfect. Then,
and then the poem is, the poem for this bird is in here in three languages. So in Dutch, German, and English. So you have to peel out the egg. Poem.
You have to have the courage to discover.
People have to buy two books.
Yeah, some of them don't want to break open the paper, so they read the poem like this.
Oh, that's not so we have to prevent that, because they have to buy two books. One they leave untouched, and one they cut them. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. You can buy that anymore, right?
Yes, it's sold out, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Do you use Riso printing and inkjet on that? Is that like hybrid?
Good question. It's not hybrid, only the cover.
Okay.
So the cover is made in Riso inkjet on the com cover. And that also has to do with that idea of smearing. So this one I have to varnish, or I have to print in screen print itself, or I can print on the Comcolor, this inkjet. So that was the reason I printed this in Comcolor, and it worked on this colored paper. So it worked beautifully. So this is the paper. So, and it it came almost in connection with the last poem. And only the cover is made by inkjet. It's both for a pragmatic reason, but it also worked with this. So if it didn't work like that, I wouldn't have done it. What I always say, I hate the word pragmatism, because it's always a compromise. But what you said, the real hybrid book, I made also quite a few of them that I really printed on top of each other. But so far, we did not do that with the series. So I have other books I did that, but never in this series. But that is a good idea, what you say now. So maybe we can also introduce that in the next, in one of the next issues.
You've used other techniques, right? We will soon see a huge print that you use letterpress and screen printing and Rizzo.
Yes, but that's, shall we go to that now? Or Amit, can you introduce this project? And then I can do a real life unboxing. Uh-huh. Yeah? That's what you see on YouTube a lot, huh? Unboxing. I have to go to
Laminaria is the name of one of the bigger seaweeds, and in spring they because of all the storms they land on the beach, and they are huge. They can be up to 3 meters. When I was collecting them and drying them, and I was very amazed and impressed by the shapes of them and their measurements. So I proposed to Jo, could we do a real size print of such a big seaweed? So Jo thought it was a good idea, but then we had to find a way how to do that.
Because actually you thought to cut it up in a book, huh?
Yeah, because we had promised each other to make books and not like huge posters. But then Jo said, well, we can do a one-to-one print, and that it can also stand up like it stands up on the water. So we did the photography in parts and did the montage in Photoshop, and then had to start printing in three different layers. And it's built up of six different papers, right? We glued together. And then there is a poem about the same, like written from the view from the seaweed. That is a letterpress printed. That's wrapped around it, and the box is silk screen. The name of it is in silk screen print.
That is the letterpress. Yeah, so I try to not to destroy it. So this is the letterpress print. It was a very, very old lead type. You see there's a lot of irregularities. And that's was the beauty of this type. You just couldn't get it very neat.
Yeah, we didn't want to have it very neat. And the color of the ink is is dark brownish, greenish, really a bit of an ugly color, but it's the color of the seaweed itself.
Yeah, Meek picked it. She made the color, I think. Because I have that nice nice image with all the those dirty fingers.
Yeah, my fingers. Right? Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. That was for the box, for the screen print on the box. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, and then this is the.
No,
there you see our Sanctum Nec Plura stamp. Do you see that? Or is it not possible to see?
A bit up, Jo, then.
Ah, okay. Yeah.
Yeah, all these big seaweeds are somehow connected to a rock to set themselves. So we also have the little rock attached to the seaweed. It is attached. Seaweed is attached to the rock bed or to the bottom, a rocky bottom of the sea. And this one was just attached to a loose pebble.
I'm too short.
You have to climb off the table.
Oh dear. Anyway, so you get an idea, huh?
And I'm very happy, but with the way how it looks still wet, the shine on the surface is really if you just pull it out of the water.
I'm wet already now.
You printed like the pages before and then you glued them. How was it?
The problem with printing this is it's six different A2 prints, and you really have to print them actually in one go, all the six of them. So that was a long day of printing, because if you don't do that, the color changes. So if I print one print tomorrow, the color is different because of humidity, the print, I don't know, whatever. So to get it right, you really have to make a very long day of printing. In this case, it really worked. So that you don't see really any color difference in the print. I was very happy with that, because in the beginning, I thought it will be impossible, but it worked. But the main work was the gluing. And then Mick, you did, I think, 3 days gluing 30 of those things and then cutting them.
Yeah,
it was
the addition was a bit less than the 100, because it was such an amount of work, and we thought, well, 30, 35 or 30 would be enough. And it was like really walking with it.
Yeah. but it says not more than 100, huh?
Yeah, no, so that's true. Yeah.
We also could make one, huh? Not more than 100.
Yeah.
But that was really a tough job. But that's also nice with Meek, because you switch her on and then she works without any hesitation. It's just till it's finished. It's unbelievable. So, but it was a really tough job to do that. But that was the break with this very nice developed series look. Yeah? So, and then we abandoned it altogether, because that was an extreme.
Yeah.
Mick made a very good photograph from it. So this is just how it was photographed. It was really very, very beautiful done.
There's a yellow layer, there's a pink layer, right?
Yellow, pink, and black in the original. And I made the separation. There was so little blue that I made a new separation to discard it completely. Because the A2, the problem is you print one color and a go. And so every color on top of it makes it more difficult to keep it clean. So every color you can skip is a gift. So, and that was But you don't see it. It was the same as the original. So there was actually almost no blue in it.
Now in number 4, right? Thinking that you made the 3 after the first one of Charles Nipples, right? And now we get to what's the 5th book?
Arandora Star. It's the name of a liner ship that went in the wartime and it was on its way to Canada, and it got torpedoed for the coast from Ireland. And one of the lifeboats of this liner is on the beach, is hidden in the sand on the beach of Knockwilligan. And there are just two hooks peeping out of the, like two hooks peeping out of the sand. And for this book, because it is really a tragedy with a loss of more than 800 people in that accident. But there's nowhere on the beach that says what it is, this boat. There is nobody will know what these two hooks are. And I thought it would be really good to give it some like more attention and try to see if we can get this little boat on the sea again in a poem. And there are quite some very good poets on Mull, and I asked Derek and Seth Crook, that's a father and a son, and they are very, very good poets. And I asked them to write a poem about that boat. So there we made, all the 3 of us made a poem about the boat. That's the inside of the book. It's very a very humble book. I think we had to recover a bit from our youth.
This, huh? So, yeah. It's the prize.
The cover is Jo can explain what he did to make the cover, maybe, because
it actually goes back to a work I made myself in the early 80s. I was working a lot with sands and letters, so I thought it was really ideal commission for this to make the word Arandora Star. And like the boat, it was covered by sand. So I actually recreated that idea of something being covered with sand. In this case, it was then the name of it. And here, and this one, the lighting is different than the sand. Letters are taken out. And that was also the same I did with this. So just that I try to refer with the title, I try to refer about the happening with the book, that it was covered by in the beach by sand. So that's what I did. And there was one negative and one positive. So one negative, positive. So actually here, this is a little example of that I'm not only so rigid that I do my own thing, because this is very much related to the subject. Yeah, so, but it fitted also a thing that I was doing. And so this is all result printed on a stencil printer, also the cover.
Yeah.
And we found a beautiful paper. It's called craft paper, but you normally only find that for packing, a thin paper for wrapping up things. But this one I could find in London with a supplier. I have also a thicker paper. So that is very nice color to the subject also. So it's a nice book. I hate oblong books. I don't like landscape books, but in this case, it could not be like this. Huh? So yeah.
How do you think
really
that paper worked? Does it like pull the ink more?
So this paper is really open, so it absorbs. So I don't have dirty fingers now. Okay? So this is not varnished. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it's also nice. It was a nice resting point after that big thing. Everything, yeah. Oh, God, let's do something humble.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that mm-hmm. is also a very interesting way to tell that story from my point of view, at least, because you see like the boat is like submerged under the sand and you see just mm-hmm. those little pieces, but it represents mm-hmm. a very strong history, right?
Yeah, we did. And after when the book came out, we organized a book launch on the beach around these two books. So there were some, I think, around 15 locals and interested people who formed the shape of the hull. And we did that, well, that is 2 years ago, but this year we did it again on the date that lifeboat on around the beginning of July that lifeboat once in 1941 came ashore. So as well, this little booklet became quite an important object that is now kind of celebrating or honoring at least what mm-hmm. happened to all these people that lost their life on sea. And then we were reading from the book, but also reading other poems about other accidents on sea or shipwrecks and all these related subjects.
Yeah, something we will get to the next book, but I would like to ask you about your work, that it seems that you have like living as an act of art. I mean, when I talk to you, it feels that you're the whole time you're an artist, you know? I feel when I receive an email from Mick, we are just discussing when we are scheduling the interview, but I feel that I'm receiving an email from an artist. Do you feel like that the things are like, they go together, like living and being in the field and collecting and being an artist, like you're an artist all the time, you know?
Yeah, that's a very good question. Maybe I even feel less an artist than I once felt that I was an artist or a writer, because living here means so many other different things that you have to do, like keeping warm and spreading seaweed over all the over the vegetable garden. So a lot of the time I spend now doing very practical things, but in doing these practical things, I find an immense beauty and as well a pleasure in just doing these simple things outside. And it is now, it really has changed since I came from Amsterdam. I think years before I would sit and I would have an idea and I would start on that work and then I would spend a lot of time in the studio. And now I have really little time in the studio, and a lot of ideas are popping up during all these other busy moments. I really had to learn that it was all right, that I had not this heap of writing hours anymore, that I had to spend more time in the kitchen and more time doing other things, and that from these things new work would arise, and not other way around, that you first wait what to do and you wait on an idea and okay, now I will make something about this, but now something happens, something that I didn't expect, or something that I just a little thing I see when I'm walking, and then I feel the need, really the need, that I can make something with this experience or with this encounter. Or last week I've seen in one of the rock pools a beautiful, it's kind of a slug, and it's called a sea hare, and it's funny, it's when it's young it is red, and when it is older it's green, because when it is young, it eats red seaweed, and when it is older, it eats green seaweed. And it has his almost on his back. It has kind of wings, and when I was looking at it, it opened its wings, and it has also little antennas that went in very strange shapes. So I'm now thinking one of our next books, at least one sea hare must appear in one of our next books. but I would never have find such a creature by just, waiting on a new idea or something. It's really something that keep happening. And I'm not sure if it was really an answer on your question, but...
Yeah, it totally was. From what I got, you saw that you have to do many things there, and you have to cook and collect and swim and everything. And if you just thought about, well, this time I have for writing and this time I have for other things wouldn't happen, right? Things that you find along the way will be part of a book or of a poem. Of course, you're there and you're feeling and talking about this place, right? Living it.
I want to always be precise, but I feel now that it opens me up, or it loses me being here. So, and I also don't want to make stiff works, or I hope to work as spontaneous as the things are happening here. And that's every day that is something that I will encounter or that will happen. And it's very different from my artist being in the city. One thing that for me it's very hard to, if people ask me if we met for the first time, what are you a writer, or I don't know what I am at the moment. I do things. Or
would you like to comment on that? We started a little about you saying what you thought about Mick and that feeling of hers also inspiring you.
Yeah, but you see nowadays, and in a way, Mick is also a Renaissance woman. But she's also very modern. You see, and with the participants that we also have now at the Jan van Eyck Academy, the boundaries are very are dissolving, so you cannot name like we used to do strictly. You are an architect, you are a curator, you are a writer. So that's really dissolving. And even in my time when I was studying at the Jan van Eyck, it was then you had sculptors, video artists, painters, drawers. So you see, it slowly fades away. So I think we, in approaching the arts, maybe we go back to the Renaissance. You don't know. It's maybe a reviving of that idea of not separating things. And Mick is an example for that. Like I said before in the beginning, also when she's interested in a subject, then she knows everything in the shortest time. And then she reflects on that, and then it can be a poem, it can be a drawing, it can be a book or whatever. Maybe she starts with video work, I don't know, or make musical compositions. So you never know with Mick what happens. So, but I think it's nothing to worry about. It's okay.
Well, we have Magical Octopus as the sixth number. So we've been discussing this book for a period now, and I think that is nice that we have like this closure participation coming back to it. But I would just like to point that people who are watching this interview can find information about it in the first interview that I've made with Jo. He was like in the process and receiving the material. And then we had the artist book conversation with artists from here and also Astrid from Knus. And then we have the magical Rizzo edition that was focused on this book. And you can find this in English at the Jan van Eyck Academy's YouTube channel and in Portuguese in Brazil. This edition of Magical Rizzo received the artist, and now we are here with Make. Make was in the program of Faísca by Magical Rizzo Broadcasting. And now it is the first participation. And what we get from this process is Make has inspired a bunch of people for creating in Rizzo. And we heard how Yo received this material and how people imagine all of that. I would like to know how you feel today, Mick, seeing that source material you provided has gotten so many ideas and so many discussions, you know?
Thinking back, it feels now almost unreal, as if it didn't happen, because it was such an intense week of talking about all the approaches and then all the time before working on the book. It was although all from a distance, it was a very, very close collaboration. Yeah, I'm every now and then I go through the book and my eye falls on some image that I didn't see before, almost, although I know all the pages now almost by heart. It all the time when I flip through, that something new happens, or some other chapter I suddenly like in a different way.
We made 200 of these, so it was against our Centrum Nec Plura thing. So the thing we invented for that is to print 100 times 2.
So you're cheating, right? Cheating.
We still are in our own borders. Huh? So, but it would be a pity to make only 100 of that, because they were gone in a week. Or even before Magical Rizzo, the most were gone.
Yeah, and we also wanted to have the all the 19 participants also got some books to share or to sell or to provide to other places like libraries and art schools. And so then suddenly the half of the edition was already handed out to the people that made the book possible.
No, it was 70% already was gone.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, even much more. Yeah.
But that was also the idea, that we made this book together and that we also shared the edition together. So that was the idea. So nobody was paid to make the book, but they just paid with their labor and their section, and then they got an equal amount of books back.
Jo also made the random version afterwards. So there were, after all the books were put together, there were some pages left. And so there's now as well a random book, which has very different connection.
He was calling it the White Album, right?
Yeah.
Your own White Album.
It's the White Album, yeah. Mm-hmm. So you get all kind of collaborations here. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So, and now we started last week working on number 8 and number 7.
You started from the 8th and then the 7th.
Yeah, we started on 8 because it takes a year to make. So the book we plan for as number 8, and it's a kind of a dialogue among each other. So we react on each other's work. And we do that on a regular basis, twice a week. And so that will be a modest black and white book we envision now. and it will then be published January 22. And another project that was actually an idea where I already work with in my own artist books. It's about reproduction in the scientific sense. And I asked Miek if she also would wanted to work in that same concept, but then with her work. So it's very cryptical, I know, but maybe I can't say more about that. Can you say more about that, Miek, without giving everything?
No, just for maybe just a little bit about AIDS, that once a week we mail each other an image, a black and white image, and it always has to refer to the one from the last week, but of course it also refers to all of the images before, because it's building up to something we don't know yet. So we did now two, and already after the first Joost response, there was some like really important questions and things like, how are we going to, what are the rules and how are we going to play this ping pong match number 7? There will be actually two books, right, Jo?
Yeah, two books. Two similar books.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. A duo book with the same material in both of the books, but slightly different in their outcome, or in their print, or in their meaning, or in their... But that's still so new that I even have to understand it a little bit better before we can really kick off, I think.
Yeah, I think Miek has to work a lot in the garden with thinking about that book. Huh? So when she's putting seaweed in the garden, she can think about the book, and then it slowly comes. And then we will see. But it's a bit critical.
We will know about it soon, I'm sure. For this goodbye, I would like to thank you a lot, because I think that for this FAISC edition, all of these talks and the work you've developed together and the magic, I'm getting a little emotional, but the process of magical octopus and everything was important. I will stop and say goodbye, so, because I'm
That's really, okay. It's really sweet for you. Thank you very much for all the work you did. That's really appreciated. Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much once again, and see you.
See you. Bye bye. Don't cut this out.
I will definitely cut this out.